Welcome once again to Caribbean Crossroads. We got a program for you today. I'm your host, David Lee. We're coming to you from St. Thomas in the U.S. Virgin Islands. We're in the port city of Charlotte, Amalie. We're standing in front of the legislature building. And next to us is Fort Christian, one of the most historic sites on the island because it was built by the Danish people. They were the original colonizers of these islands. The fort overlooks a very busy harbor. Tourist ships coming in and out from all over the world, and the yachting community, cruisers going to and fro up and down the islands of the sea. We have an exciting program for you today with the junior middleweight champion of the world. That's boxing. We're talking WBA champion, Julian Jackson. We're standing next to a big gun, but we got a bigger gun today. Stay around for a wonderful interview with Julian. Julian, tell us how it all started. How did you get started in boxing?
Well, I started at a very young age, around 12 years old. And it was like a street brawl.
Really?
Yeah. And an old man by the name of Willie George, my former trainer, deceased trainer, came and braked it up. And he said, "You guys want to use your fists? Come into my gym. And I'll put on some gloves with you and you could knock yourself out." And we went in there and he put on this glove and...
The same group of guys?
The same group of guys. And I was the one in the middle and I was one of the guys fighting. And I went in there and he put on the gloves and we started boxing, man. And believe me, I got my nose, my eyes all bumped up, you know. And somehow, you know, I liked it and I didn't go back a few days, but my friend, my best friend, he continued. So, you know, when he told me, it was real nice. And Willie had a lot of interesting stories about Africa and where he lived he stayed in Italy. And there was a lot of exciting things, you know, that was told to him. And I wanted to hear them. And I went in and I joined the gym. And from there, you know, I stuck with it. This is in St. Thomas.
Okay, now when did you finally make a decision that that was what you wanted to do with your life?
Well, just by the stories that this man was telling me and the places that he'd been to.
Was he a fighter or a trainer?
He was a trainer at the time. Uh-huh. And he was once a fighter, you know, a prize fighter. And he told me that we could see all these places and we could go and meet all these different people. And it sounded real good to me, you know. And I wanted to see these places. I wanted to go and really travel. And I decided to join the gym. And I went in there and I started training and he started showing me, you know. And I grew to like it, man. And I stayed there. And eventually I started, my first amateur fight was in the like in the Robert Stadium. And first time I ever won anything like on my own, you know.
Right.
I was the one in there and I was the one working and I won, man. And I felt so good, you know. And it came a part of me, man. And I stayed with it. And
what
thank
age
God.
Was that now when that first time that you won a
okay.
fight?
I was about maybe 13 or 14 years after
right.
that because I stayed in there quite a few years before I fought. And training in the gym every day was so much competition with other guys, and you know, it was so, and I always loved the challenge. I always loved the challenge, and that was something that was in me, and you know, it worked out for the good.
So let's go to the next major breakthrough in your fighting career. I mean, you won that first fight, but when did the next, you know, real?
Well, I started training and fighting more, and then we start going to Puerto Rico and St. Croix, our neighbor, our sister island.
Uh-huh.
And we started competing with those fighters over there, and I was doing pretty good. In my amateur career, I lost 2 fights, and I won 15.
Wow.
So I had 17 fights in all and lost 2. And I went to the Pan American Games in Puerto Rico, where I came in 6. I got a certificate, but I didn't win any medal. But I was proud that I had the opportunity and the exposure in an international meet like that.
Now that's people from all over the world.
Oh, definitely. And I really enjoyed it. I really did.
What year was that, the Pan American Games?
That was 79.
Uh-huh.
I was in 79.
Now that was still in an amateur
status. Still
in
amateur.
Now when
now,
did
after
you make
that, after that meet, we were scheduled to go to the Olympics. And at that time, it was boycotted by President Jimmy Carter.
Right.
And we didn't get to go. And that hurt me so much, you know. I wanted to go and I felt like, well, you know, that was the main goal as an amateur, and I didn't get a chance to. I was getting older, and, you know, then I started thinking about pro, you know, turning pro, and, you know, what would be the risk training here in the Virgin Islands. And I spoke to my trainer and stuff like that, and he said, well, let's think about it and, you know, let's sleep on it a bit. So I did, and I decided to turn pro here in St. Thomas, and when my friends and the local and my fans heard about it, they wanted me to go away to the States, where they felt I would have got a lot more, you know, recognition and maybe equipment and spa mates and all of that. But I felt I could have done it right here, because I knew that Willie George was an excellent trainer, and he was the best in the world, and I knew that. But the local people didn't know that, because they hardly come out to see me train and stuff like that. But anyway, he died afterward. He died. And I mean, he went with a part of me, and believe me, but he left behind a champion in the making. He put something inside of me and showed me that I could be somebody. I am somebody. And all I have to do is trust in in myself and have faith in myself. And he always tell me there's 2 things that we are put here to do. And I admire him for that. He said, we are here to do 2 things. That's to serve God and to help your fellow man. And he said, Julian, I'm here to help you. And to prove that, he took a dollar bill. He said, if I have my last dollar bill, half is yours and half is mine. And he tore the dollar bill and gave me a half, and he took a half.
And I bet you still have your half.
Oh, man. He was like a father to me.
Amen.
You know.
That's good. So you turned pro.
I turned pro.
And now what happens then?
And then he died, and the assistant trainer was Sustin Verley, now my current trainer. And he is pretty good himself. And as a matter of fact, he was a fighter himself, the best here in St. Thomas in his time. And there was nobody else that could have taken the place of Willie but him. And I assigned him as my chief trainer here in the Virgin Islands. And a promoter by the name of Russell Nana, local promoter, came. And we got together and we decided, hey, let's take a shot of it. And I went from there in my professional career.
And that's led you through the last few years. Now, how long have you been the WBA champion at the weight you're fighting at
Well, I've
now?
Been the WBA champion now for 2 years.
And how many times did you defend that?
I defended it 3 times.
Fantastic. And just recently, even.
Just recently.
Yeah. Well, we don't know when this program might air, you know, but I believe by faith that you're going to be the WBA champion for a long time.
Thank you very much.
Praise God.
Thank you.
So now, the point we're at now, we want to hear how this latest development has affected your fighting career and your life and your marriage and stuff, because how long ago did you come to know the Lord Jesus Christ?
Well, just about the same time.
And how did that happen?
And my first attempt to win fight for the junior middleweight champion of the world, I lost. And I came home, and the people greet me fairly well, and I was very depressed. I felt like, you know, I lost everything. And everybody, I felt my family would have turned against me, my friends. And I felt that you know, I just wanted to give up, and I, you know, I was like in a state where there was no more hope. It was everything to me to win a title for the Virgin Islands, my hometown, and I didn't do it. And I came home after that fight, and about two or three different individuals came up to me and said, Jackson, I said, yes, sir, you know, you could have won that fight, but you couldn't because the devil was involved. I said, the devil was involved? He said, yes, the devil was involved. I don't think you understand what I'm saying, but I want you to listen to me. If you get a chance to fight for a next title, you have to go and find out. You got to go to somebody they call a witchcraft or Obey man, and to get myself ready, because I was not fighting just a physical fight, but you were fighting a spiritual fight. And there was witchcraft involved in that fight. And, you know, I just shrugged my shoulder and, you know, forgot about it. But somebody else called me on the phone and told me exactly the same thing. That I was, they knew that before I entered the ring, I was going to lose. Because they visit somebody and they told them that Jackson is going to lose this fight. He could beat the fellow, but he's going to lose. And this person told me this thing, and I said, you know, I mean, what's this? What does this supposed to mean? What does that mean? They said, well, you know, in this world, there are people with gifts, and there are people with power, and certain things like that. But I couldn't understand, you know. Right. I really couldn't cope with what they were telling me. So,
did you have any background in church or at this time? I mean, had you been going to church or raised around the church?
Yes, I was. I was. My mother was very religious, and but at that time, church to me was, at that age, was an everyday thing, something that you do every Sunday.
Right.
You know,
right.
And not really focusing on Jesus Christ.
Uh-huh.
And the love and the faith and all of that.
Amen.
So, and my brother was a pastor at the time. But there's something that, some way or the other, I could not approach him with this.
Right.
I kept it to myself, and a third individual came to me and told me almost the same thing, related with the same thing. And it started to affect me really bad, and I started to get really upset quick. I would get my wife, I would, you know, pick on her, and I couldn't sleep at night. And all out in the back of my head was to go to these people. Can I, you know, I want to win a championship. You know, should I go to these people? And I realized that it was getting to a point where I was actually starting to get real aggressive with my wife, with my, even with my mother. There was a time where police actually had to come to my house because I was beating my wife.
Wow.
I was broken down the door in my mother's bedroom and going after her. And
you know, the scripture says that the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy.
Yes.
Now, God had a plan for your life,
yes,
and to use your life as a witness to others. And the two things that Satan put your eyes on was you put all your dependency on that title.
Yes.
And when that title wasn't there, boy, you crashed.
Oh,
you
man.
Just fell down.
And the devil was coming at me.
From every angle.
He found the opportunity now where I was depressed. You know, I needed it that bad,
yeah,
you know, and I would do anything. And somehow, you know, I got to where I decided I have to make a decision if I'm going to go to these people or not. I went to my trainer. He was the only one that I spoke about this situation. And he didn't know. And I told him, I said, Sustin, there's something terribly wrong, man. And I don't know what it is, but people have been coming to me and telling me stuff about the devil and about witchcraft and Obey, and I don't really believe it, I don't understand it, but it's something is wrong.
Right.
And he told me, he said, Julian, he said, you know, I was afraid to tell you this, but this is not the first time I heard about this. He said, people came to me and told me the same thing. I didn't want to tell you to scare you or anything. And I tell him, I said, but what's all of this? And he sat me down and he knew a little bit about the situation. And he told me, hey, it's no problem to go and get somebody to find out what's wrong, if somebody's messing with you. I say, yeah, but isn't that the same as you going there and messing with it? I say, I believe in God. You know, maybe I'm not living for him the way I should, but I believe that there is a God. And I said, if I do that, I don't think I'll ever be able to pray to my God. And I said, well, I'm not going to, you know, I'd rather lose my fight. I made that decision. I don't know why, but I made that decision. And I said, you know what? I'm going to lose my fight before I go to the devil for any help. And right in that situation, we got a call from my promoter in New York, Don King, that I was in line to fight for a next championship.
Right in the middle of it.
Right in the middle of it.
Oh,
and
brother.
I knew I was not ready mentally. I couldn't make that fight. And still, my brother wasn't in mind. My pastor brother.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, it comes now, a day before I'm supposed to go. He always come and pray with me. And it was in my heart to tell him, but I don't know why there was just this urgency not to tell him.
Yeah.
And I didn't, somehow I didn't get to tell him. And we went to the airport the next day and our flight got delayed. And here it is, I saw him coming running to the, you know, into the terminal. And he said, Julian. I said, what's up? Hey, what you doing here, Dean? He said, man, I have to see you some way, some reason. I just have to see you before you leave. He said, I got to see you before you leave. Something just sent me to come and see you now. And, you know, I just thought about it. I said, Dean, there's something I wanted to tell you, but I couldn't find the courage. I don't know why I didn't tell you before, but I had enough time. The flight was delayed for about an hour, and I had enough time to tell him what I was going through. And he told me, he said, Bucci, my nickname is Bucci. He said, Bucci, you know what? The devil wants you.
That's right.
He wants to take away what God wants to give you. And he said, if you want to win that championship, I want you to accept Christ right now, right here in this airport. I said, Dean, there's nothing more that I want. But he said, you know, you gotta mean it sincerely from your heart. And I said, Dean, if I don't mean it, believe me, I think this is the answer I needed. You know, and somehow I wasn't coming to you. I don't know why. But I want God now, I need Jesus now, man. And I accepted Jesus Christ on that airport.
Praise God.
And I went away, you know, feeling much better.
Uh-huh.
And I got up there and training, man. And all of a sudden, it was the worst training I've ever been in. It was the worst training I got knocked down. I got my eye bruised, I got my nose busted. And it's like, you know, I accepted Christ. What's the matter now? And things was looking bad. My trainer was very upset. He said, Julian, this is your last chance. What's happening? You know, you won't have an next break.
That's right.
You don't look good. You know, you get yourself together. And man, one night about 3 o'clock in the morning, I got up and I went on my bedside on my knees. And I prayed to God. I said, God, I accepted you. And I didn't choose the devil. I could have gone on the devil's side, but I accepted you, and I want you to give me back my timing. I want you to give me back my speed, my strength, and
praise
everything.
God.
And when I done said that prayer, I felt something lift inside
of me. Brother.
And I couldn't wait to get up in the morning. And when I got up, I said, Sustin, I woke up my trainer early. I said, Sustin. He said, what happened? I said, you know, last night I prayed, and God revealed to me that this is going to be my easiest fight. He said, your easiest fight? He said, I want you to take this fight serious. Did you see how, you know how you're looking in the gym? This is not a joke, Julian. Come on, let's go. I said, Sustin, God told me this is going to be my easiest fight. And I felt a new strength inside of me. And I went back to the gym the next day. And the guy that knocked me down and my trainer was telling me, let's put him off for a couple more days. I said, no, I want him now. And they put him in, man. We were scheduled to go 4 rounds. He could only go 3. They had to take the glove off of him, man. My trainer was outside, yeah, yes, Julian, yes. And when I came out the ring, he said, man, Julian, whatever you did last night, you keep doing it. And I was just there, praise God, praise God. My speech my thoughts were so much different in that one, that just by that one prayer. And I kept reading the Bible every night, and I keep accepting that feeling. You know, it didn't leave me. And fight night came, and everybody was telling me, hey, this kid is the toughest kid out of Korea. Expect to go 12 rounds. If you knock him down, he's gonna get back up, and this is the toughest fight you're gonna be in, Julian. My promoter, Dan King, sent a message with his son and told me that, hey, you better be ready to fight. And, you know, you better prepare to take some good shots because this kid is good. And all these negative things were coming. And all I said to him, this kid, I said, you go back and tell your father that this is gonna be my easiest fight.
God hadn't given me the spirit of fear, but of power.
I went in that ring, man. And that ring was scheduled to go 12 rounds. I didn't get a scratch. I didn't get he hardly touched me. And I knocked him out in the third round. And everybody, and I went back in my room, in my dressing room. As a matter of fact, after I knocked him down in that third round, the referee counted him out. I dropped to my knees, man. And I put my hands up to God and I said, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord. You know, and after I went into my room, the reporters came to me and started asking me about the fight. And I told them, like, look, this fight was more than a physical fight. This was a spiritual fight for me. They didn't understand what I was saying. You know, but my trainer knew. He knew what I was going through, and today he's accepted. Today he's a Christian.
Praise God.
He's accepted Christ.
You know, the scripture that comes to my mind is that in Deuteronomy 8 it says he takes us through the wilderness to test us, to try us, to prove us, to find out where our heart is really at. And when he saw your heart, when you got on the side of the bed that night and turned it completely over to him and give him lordship so he could really give you the power that you wanted, boom, he's faithful to come, boy, and do the job.
Ever since then, God has been doing some tremendous thing in my life. And there's no way, I mean, if I could proclaim him throughout the world, man, I'll do it. I'm doing it, and I thank God for the full business gospel, for giving me the opportunity to preach in the three different islands before I left. And that was a real
encouragement.
So
you were able to share
me.
Your testimony at the full gospel business chapters.
Yes. You know, and you know, in Ephesians 6:12, and I couldn't understand that, but I realized that in Ephesians 6:12, it says that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against the powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And I realized that I was in that battle.
You lived it.
Oh, yeah. And believe me, after that experience, God have done a tremendous work in my life, and I praise him every day, and I thank him. And my wife is saved, my brother, my mother, everybody got affected by what Jesus Christ did for me.
And how close you came to making that wrong
decision. Oh, that wrong decision, man.
But God had his hand on it, see?
Oh, definitely.
He was drawing you, and the plane was late, definitely. And he set up the whole thing. Now, to the world, they'd say, oh, that was coincidence. But coincidence is just when God wants to remain anonymous in the situation.
See,
you know?
And I realize, especially here in my hometown and in the churches that I've attended, you know, a lot of people don't realize what Jesus wants to do with us.
Yeah.
You know, the church is supposed to be the body of Christ.
That's right.
But yet, we are so weak in faith, and we take God for granted. And there's a lot of things happening here in these islands. And because of the weakness of the church, these things are destroying families. Mm-hmm. This spirit world is something that you cannot relate to unless you get into the spirit of God.
Julian, why don't you take a minute and just look right at the camera and just invite young people, old people, whomever, that might have been touched by your testimony. Just share a little bit more on how they could know the Lord Jesus Christ.
You know, I realize, especially here in my hometown, that a lot of young people feel that if they accept Christ, that they're gonna miss all the fun, all the parties, and all the, you know, the joy of the world. But, you know, I would just like to let them know something, that without Christ, I really believe that joy is counterfeited. That it's to rob you of your love, your joy from God. And I realized I was heading in that direction, because when I accepted Christ, what came to my mind was my friends, my parties, my discoing, my, you know, all that music and all those girls. And I had to make a decision. Am I going to let they take me to hell? Am I going to let music take me to hell? Am I going to let a few songs and disco rob me of what Jesus Christ, you know, wants to give me? And we all have to make that decision. And believe me, there's as much more joy, there's more love, more fun. I've never been so happy in my life. Now that I have Christ in my life, my kids I enjoy more, my wife, I love her so much. You know, I could never have a next woman.
Amen.
You know, and
amen.
I thank God for giving me that joy. And I never thought that Christians could be so happy. But until I made that stand, God instilled a great love inside of me. And I just thank Him every day and for every moment.
We give Him the glory today for what we just heard. And I thank you for being here today with
us
on Caribbean Crossroads. And we are going to be praying for you. And we're going to see you one of these days in the ring there and on your knees giving glory to God. And we're all going to be playing a part in the victory.
Thank you very much.
Praise God, brother.
Praise God.
You folks out there, you be praying for Julian Jackson and the gift that God has given him to be used mightily, that God would get glory and that he would get glory in the islands of the sea. We invite you to come back next week. We don't know where we'll be. We could be visiting your island in the sun. Come back and be with us once again on Caribbean Crossroads. Yeah.